Greetings, how are you doing? Welcome to Simnaya, and thank you all so much for the support. Hope you all are doing great. So today we'll be talking something very important, and it's about white rage, how white people see it, like they feel like black people are not supposed to live good lives and all that. And when they see black people doing some certain things, they start questioning. Or when they see black people in some neighborhood, the next thing they are going to think is that maybe this person is a criminal that wants to rob or something, and they start calling the cops on the person. And I have seen somebody in his own house being arrested for breaking in. How can somebody break into his own house? And one thing with all these cops is that they do not even ask, like, you know, they don't even come down to start asking questions. They start treating you straight up like a criminal and all that. And when they see black people in first class or doing great things for them, they are like enraged, like, how could they, you know, afford something like this and all that? Or when they see black people in some stores, they are like, are you sure he can afford this? You know, giving attitude when attitude is not even needed and all that. I am sure most of you have experienced this, probably in your workplace and all that. When they see you doing something, they are like, how could she? Okay, now let me tell you all something. We had a end of the year party 2 days ago. I think that was on Wednesday. And I took pictures with some people. They were like, can I take pictures with you? And I used my phone. I took the pictures. And guess what? So they were like, they want to take the pictures. And I was like, okay, you can take my phone and, like, you know, and send it to you. I mean, airport and, sorry, iPhone, and select the ones you want and send it. Guess what? They were asking me, iPhone, what are you using? I am like, I'm using iPhone. Which one is iPhone? What am I using? Let's get into this video.
Rich Black TikTok has spoken. You have been questioned about your first class plane flights. You have been asked where the owner of this house is. You have been demanded to prove why you are at a cultural institution and why, and how you know anything about this art form. You have even been at the dollar store, all in black, where all the other employees are wearing green, and a woman has come up to you and asked you if you could please help her with her purchase. And these are just the light, funny versions of those questions. In the movie that has delighted audiences and rich black people everywhere and annoyed to no end Charlie Kirk, we have another similar scene where Mahershala Ali's character, G.H. Scott, is not believed to be the owner of the house that he owns. This scene was believable because it has been experienced by so many of you. And we talked about it, but inevitably, when we talk about these things, there's always the pearl-clutching, no way. How could anybody assume that of you? What do you mean people are out here assuming that black people don't have nice things? Now, when I was younger and I would hear ladies respond to my mother lightheartedly talking about her day, I thought, yeah, maybe that was a one-off thing. Maybe that's not something that actually happens. One of the things the history bros, I don't even know if that's a thing, history bros, but anyways, something people like to do is say that, look, the Civil War happened. Now you guys got to become citizens. You've had generations to catch up, to get wealthy, to have all the things that American capitalism promises you. If you don't have it now, it's because something's wrong with you. And the reason you don't see yourself everywhere and why you're not represented is because you just didn't pull yourself up by the bootstraps hard enough. Of course, that perspective is easily shot down by a couple books, right? But the other one that's a little bit sneakier is the one that I've run into, which is, well, look, Abraham Lincoln and all these people, they worked really hard to try to correct that. And what's going on? Why hasn't the correction taken? Well, I took a minute to keep reading a little bit of Carol Anderson's White Rage. She's a great historian. And there's a meeting that Abraham Lincoln had that kind of made things a little bit clearer. Reconstruction, the 13th Amendment and the 14th Amendment, and these other laws that came into being, were supposed to be this great reset, right? They were supposed to be the time where we say, okay, these people that have been forced, exploited, free labor, they're now citizens, and they're now entitled to the things that citizenship gives. And now we've got to rework our laws. We got to rework the very fabric of how we started this to make sure that they have a shot. Now, most of us learn that those things happen, 13th Amendment, 14th Amendment, Reconstruction, radical Reconstruction, and we think, okay, it happened. But then we don't get taught about the rollbacks and the ways that every single thing I just mentioned were fought tooth and nail to make sure that their promise never came true. And it's why when people like him and people like us are in places we're in, it's literally because that was not the plan. It was not the plan of many of our neighbors and people around us. Their ancestors wanted to make sure that every single step of progress that was being done or enacted would not actually take. So it's no surprise that people are shocked when they see you where they're not supposed to see you. All I want to do today is talk about Lincoln's two intellectual heroes and a meeting he had, and how that impacted the strength of Reconstruction. Okay, these weren't his only intellectual heroes, but they were significant. We've got Thomas Jefferson and Henry Clay from Kentucky. Thomas Jefferson's great plan, I should remind you, to save America was to just take all the slaves, enslaved people, all the African Americans, and just remove them from the United States. So there's that. Henry Clay started the American Colonization Society and had actually successfully moved thousands of free black people out of the United States. So Lincoln is like, wait, this might work. What if I just get millions of formerly enslaved people to move to Panama, and specifically to a resource poor part of Panama? Okay, I don't know how that was gonna work, but he was like, okay, now all we have to do is convince them. So in August of 1862, five influential black leaders are summoned to the White House, and there Lincoln tells them, because of what your people have done to our United States, it's your duty to make a mass exodus to South America. Then he tells them, if not for your race among us, basically, there would be no war. Carol Anderson, Professor Dr. Carol Anderson, makes sure to remind us, how did this race come to be among us, and who was fighting this war in the first place? These are the same formerly enslaved or free black people who had fought to protect the Union. People who were fighting for a nation that hadn't even given them basic humanity and dignity from the beginning. They, the great emancipator, Abraham Lincoln, thought that they were the problem. Not necessarily the traitors who enslaved them in the first place, and when they couldn't get their way, threw a fit and threatened and left the country. So yeah, we argue now, unfortunately, about the cause and the point and the purpose of the Civil War, and we cast Lincoln and all these people who put forth these Emancipation Proclamations and things like that as clear-cut, we know what they were fighting for. And in the end, there's this lack of clarity even about how they see these black people and if they even want them to actually have a full pursuit of happiness, life, and liberty here in the U.S. So then we wonder, decades, generations later, why there's still this anger and animosity towards seeing black people in positions of power, black people in positions of wealth. Not saying that those things save you, because remember, the whole thing exists for a class caste system. Race is just the technology, that the story that's invented to keep that in place, as I've said a million times. But now you can understand a little bit of why people act like you shouldn't be there, because everybody up to that point who came before them thought so, unless they were radical abolitionists or people with these deep set convictions that ran against the grain of the general population at the time. The first duty of the Southern states, in their own words, was the preservation of their states. And by the preservation, we know what they meant by that. It was the preservation of slave owning business. When the Civil War ended and Reconstruction began, and then even radical Reconstruction began, the Southern states moved in quick step to make sure they could undo any law, any advancement, any economic or political right that black people were gaining. They stripped it away. If they couldn't strip it away legally, they would do it extra legally through terrorism. It's been maybe, what, 50 years since massive legal legislation has been put in place to make sure that African Americans cannot be economically and politically disenfranchised. It's only been that small amount of time. Why do we think the culture or the treatment we're going to get is going to be open door favorable all the time. It just can't be, and the history tells us why. So we can run around and we can be confused. We could pretend that the stories that people tell us aren't happening or aren't true. But to do so is to say that structural economic racism did not happen, and there is nothing in history that lets you back that up.
So this is all I got from this video. Trust me, this is really very interesting, and I am sure so many Black people might have experienced something like this one way or the other. So many Black people I have also brought them, some of them here, have been questioned about their home. I have seen a Black man right in front of his house, and he was arrested for breaking into his own house because the neighbors somewhere probably saw a Black man and ended up calling the cops to come and arrest him. And they even were very forceful, and he was screaming, "This is my home, this is my house." I mean, so the reality is that these people, sincerely speaking, do not even think that Black people are supposed to own anything or even live better lives, you know? And I am sure that you all may have experienced this flight of a thing. Probably traveling and you bought first class or business class, I don't know, whichever one, ticket, and they are looking at you like you're a criminal or you stole. It is ticket that you bought, and you see them giving you attitude with your own money. And so I have seen people also, Black people, that went shopping and they were putting something in the car. And guess what? The person that worked there will call the cops, like, the things that they are putting in their cart are expensive. Like, how can they afford it? How can they afford it? I mean, there are some things you hear, and you might be a house owner or a car owner, and they are asking you, let me tell you all something. I remember buying a gift, birthday gift for somebody, right? And this person was like screaming, "This is so expensive. How could you afford this?" I am like, if you don't want it, give it back to me. Because which one is, how did you afford, how could you afford it? Instead of you to take birthday gift, and you're asking me, this is like, how could you afford it? Like, what kind of nonsense is that one? So you see, all these things are the things that they do to Black people, because they feel like Black people are not supposed to be rich. Black people are not supposed to be well doing and all that. And also, there was a video that I think, I can't remember the chat where I posted it. And a young baby, a child, 6-7 years, was like giving a Black woman money. The woman was like, "Why are you giving me money? Like, I should be the one giving you money." She said, "No, because Black people are poor." And the woman was like, "Say no more." And there are some things that will happen to you, especially from also kids, and you are dumbfounded. Like, who told you that? How did you even know this? You know? So all these things are, some of them are being fed in their homes, like, you know, what they probably hear their parents do. And some are just blatantly read to the seas that they cannot even hide it anymore. And you say, okay, I have a story that was, I think last year, I traveled, I bought a first class ticket, and guess what? While we were on queue, because they have, like, you know, how they check in, VIP and all that. While I was on queue, I can't even remember where they are from, but they look Arab or something. And they were like laughing at me, like, how could she, you know? We know when you see people doing some demeaning thing, like, you know, to make you feel like you do not even belong. And guess what? When we boarded, I found out that even where my seat is more expensive too, because they were like way, way, way back behind where I was. So these people can do anything to make you feel like you do not belong, or like, you know, you are not. Why? How can you afford this? I mean, share your stories, because I know, like, it's like something very common when they see Black people's wealth. I mean, it's like white rage and the rest of it. Thanks to you all in my next video. Bye.